This is Viterbi Voices.
Coming to you from the University of Southern California, Viterbi School of Engineering.
We're here to give you the inside scoop on research, classes, student life, and so much more.
All of these shared by students, faculty, alumni, and other members of the USC community.
Well, hello again, everybody, and welcome to another episode of Viterbi Voices. As usual, I am one of your hosts. My name is Paul Ledesma, the Executive Director of Undergraduate Admission here at the USC Viterbi School of Engineering.
Hello, everyone. I'm Maya, a current senior studying Industrial and Systems Engineering here at the Viterbi School of Engineering. Yeah, I feel like I should switch it up, but I don't know how.
Have we talked about this before? Like every time I do the intro, I think that it should be something different. And then I end up saying exactly the same thing. And then I think to myself, well, maybe there's reliability in saying the same thing. And that's what's helpful. But is it funnier or more interesting to be dynamic? And then I don't know what to say. And so then I'm back with saying the same thing.
Mm-hmm. Maybe that's it. Maybe it'll be a 2024 thing. You know, we'll switch up the intro outro.
And all 10 of our listeners, I'm sure, would have lots of opinions on this. Well, it is rounding out. We are circling the drain on 2023. It is Thanksgiving weekend for those of us in the United States and those who celebrate Thanksgiving. This is coming out the Sunday after Thanksgiving. So we're for all transparency purposes, we are recording this prior to Thanksgiving. Mm-hmm. So we're going to kind of talk about the future while in the past, if that makes any sense. Lots of stuff I'm sure is going through everybody's minds right now. And it, especially for our students, Maya, Thanksgiving's weird because it's a break, but then you're about to go straight into finals. Like how does that work with you? Like what is this time period all like for you as a student?
I'm glad you asked, Paul. Yeah, one of my friends just texted me like Thanksgiving break is a trap. Like I have so much work. And I think that captures it really well. You know, it's a trap. Like they tell you it's a break. You have 3 days off of school. Everybody goes home. So I'll be flying home later today. But it really is a trap because I have like the busiest week of definitely of the semester, maybe of like
next week,
the entirety of college next week, because almost all of my classes are like our final deliverable is a project and that project has to be before finals week. So that's the week after Thanksgiving, which it's like, so yes, it's nice to go home, but it's going to be a lot of studying and prep.
Is the last day of class December 1st?
I believe so. Yeah, that the Friday of the week that we get back.
So last day of class was December 1st, which means that for most of your classes, you don't have finals, you have projects too.
Yes, which is really nice. You know, once December 1st hits, I'm going to have like the best week of my life. You know, I have one final that's like open book, open note, the class is a breeze. So I'm looking forward to finals week. I'm not looking forward to the week before.
Okay. Good. So next week sucks. But after that, it's so Thanksgiving is a trap. It really is. Mm-hmm. It's like, oh, good. You're on break. But no. You should be prepping and finalizing everything for next week.
Yeah. And USC ends relatively early. And I think for some people, it depends on their final schedule. But like Thanksgiving is like so close to winter break that like, I don't know, you come back and it's just brutal.
Yeah.
Because you get used to that.
We should clarify that Maya's schedule is all projects and not finals, but not everybody's, just true, to be really, really clear. There are some students hearing this saying, this does not represent me. and that's kind of what Maya was referring to, in that the last day of classes is December 1st. And some classes will be project-based. And as you get older and seniors, more and more of them are project-based. And I think you're going to love-hate that relationship.
Yeah.
Like when you have all finals, you want nothing but projects. When you have all projects, you want nothing but finals. I think it's kind of like grass is always greener on the other side. Last day of class is the December 1st. So that means we get 2 days of stop day, which means no class, no test, no nothing. Is that the 4th and the 5th?
Yeah, the Monday and Tuesday, I think it's actually Monday, Tuesday, maybe Wednesday of that week. Those are the dead. That's like dead week is what they call it. So those are study days where like nothing can be due. Like even if your teachers want to make something due on those days, it's like against the university guidelines, I think, to have it then.
Yes.
So yes, that's why my teachers have everything due the week before.
The week before. So you get it all done inside of class. And then finals last a week and a half. And finals are basically, depending on when your schedule is, sometimes students have finals like the first 3 days and then you're done. Sometimes they're spread out over all 7 of those days. Mm-hmm. And everybody loves to hate their whatever final schedule they got. Like, oh my God, they're all up front. Or, oh my God, they're all at the end. Or, oh my God, they're spread out across every single day. I mean, when you have nothing but finals, Maya, do you have a preferred ideal final schedule?
Definitely everything up front, because then I can either go home earlier or I can just like relax for a couple of days and do nothing.
That's got to be a great feeling to be able to be like, I'm done. You're packing up your stuff. And is the feeling really great when you're packing up your stuff and you're leaving your roommate who's like just in misery by themselves for the next 2 days? Is that why it feels so good?
Oh, yeah. I don't know if I've experienced that. Because I guess normally I have had a final on one of the later days.
So you've been the one left behind.
Maybe. But my roommate's really good about it, where she'll stay, but it'll be like, it'll like kill me on the inside, because she'll be like baking banana bread and like dancing around to music. I'm like, oh yeah, I'm just about to go to my final. But I will say that the study days at the beginning of finals week are really valuable. And I've never felt like I didn't have enough time to prepare for my finals, which has also been good.
How would you describe either your personal or in general, what the vibes are like when people are studying for finals at USC? That's an interesting question, because I think I think there's lore and legend. Like, is it depressing? Is it fun? Are there things that happen on a regular schedule?
Yeah. So there are definitely, we'll start with the fun things. Like USC actually has some fun traditions as well. Like, I know one of the freshman dining halls opens, like I think at midnight or some late time with breakfast that people can go to. And then also like the marching band will like come and play at like midnight outside of one of the libraries. So that's kind of fun too.
Yep. Yeah.
Is if you're not like super, super on the grind studying. And then, yeah, just in general around campus, also a lot of resources are available to help you with studying. So a lot of the clubs will have like study days. They'll offer snacks and like everybody will come together. So it's kind of like a collective study, which is really nice. But it is hard. It is a grind. And I think it kind of depends on just how focused and how the rest of your semester went. You know, like some people's finals will matter more than other people's. Mm-hmm. It's pretty variable based on the class, but it's very clearly outlined in the syllabus. Like, it's difficult, but like there's kind of that fun in that it's difficult, but we're all doing it together and we're all going through the same thing.
In your experience, have most of your finals been cumulative of the entire year, or were they just whatever the last segment was of your class?
Yeah, pretty dependent. I think at the beginning of college, like when I was taking more math and science classes, those were cumulative. But like with my industrial engineering classes, like we tend to have, like if you have more midterms, then I feel like it's less likely to be cumulative.
Yeah. So I always found, at least watching from the outside, that engineers are not as stressed about finals as the liberal arts majors are, because engineers are kind of making progressive work all year. Like, there's these constant check-ins, constant problem sets, and the workload kind of builds over time. And there's stress, I think, regarding projects, because then you're like trying to do everything for that project. Mm-hmm. But I feel like the liberal arts students are like, oh my God, I was supposed to be reading 15 books and I've read 3 of them, so I have to cram. Like, the idea of cramming exists more with non-engineering majors, I feel like. I'm sure, of course, it exists in areas, but I just feel like the legends regarding like, oh my God, I have to learn an entire semester in 2 nights isn't the case with engineers.
Yeah. And I think it's dependent on the person as well. You know, like if you're the type who's on top of their homework, and like I will say completely confidently, like I am normally quite on top of my homework. I've never pulled an all-nighter. I've never felt the need to like stay up super late needing to finish something. Like, there definitely have been like later nights, but I'm not a night studier. I'm a sleeper for sure. So like there's still that opportunity. I don't know. That's one fallacy of engineering in college. I think people are like, oh, you're going to stay up all night working on these projects. And it's like, you don't have to if you don't want to. You know, there are other ways you can organize your work and be able to, I don't know, get 8 hours of sleep, or like still see your friends or do a different hobby.
Yeah, yep. Totally. We do have an actual episode here. We've been talking for so long that I forgot we have an actual episode. Do you want to tell everybody what this episode is all about, and then we can come back and chat on the backside of this?
Yeah, this is an episode that I'm really excited about. I had this idea at the beginning of the semester. Just like a bunch of prospective students were asking, like, I don't know, like, what can I expect? What do I expect in my first year? And I realized that it's been a while since I've been a first year student myself. So I'm interviewing this amazing first year. Her name is Kaylena. She is a first year studying environmental engineering. You'll hear her intro and her talk, but we just went over like, what's her experience freshman year? What has it been like in the first couple months as a USC student? You know, like, what were some things that she thought of going in? What were her experiences being here? What are her favorite parts? What are her classes like? So I think it's a really good profile of like a first year student. Like, this is a sample of something that you could experience.
Yeah. So many expectations coming out of high school, so many challenges a student will find, and life shifts and moves a lot in a student's first year in college, regardless of the university they attend. So let's jump right into this episode to hear a student living their first year and having that on the ground experience. And then we will join you on the back end for talk of turkey, pumpkin pie, and all other sorts of trap celebrations.
Right. Hello, everybody. Welcome back to another episode of Viterbi Voices. I'm one of your co-hosts. My name is Maya, and I'm here with a very special guest today. Well, I guess first, I'm a senior. I study industrial and systems engineering. But yeah, I'll have my guest introduce themselves.
So hi, I'm Kaylena, and I'm currently a freshman studying environmental engineering, and I'm really excited to be here.
Woohoo! And I'm very excited that Kaylena is here too, because we haven't had a freshman on the podcast in a while. I think that's like, it's a pretty common question that people ask, and I'm very excited to hear her experiences with USC for context where, I don't know, what week are we into the semester? Is it like?
I think it's like week 10 or 11.
Week 10 or 11, which is crazy. The time seems like it's flown by. I don't know. What are your thoughts? Has it gone by fast for you?
I don't know. Some weeks it goes by really fast, and then other times it's just kind of slow. But then I think about it, and I'm like, man, we're already on week 11, which I think is crazy.
Yeah. Awesome. Well, I'm very happy to have you here today. For all of the people listening, I'll have you, if you don't mind, give a little bit more of a background, like where you're from, what you study, maybe like what made you want to study that, like whatever you want to share.
So I'm from Baldwin Park, California, and I went to Minervia High School, which is like a little city in the middle of SoCal. Mm-hmm. And I guess the reason why I chose environmental engineering, I'm just really passionate about environmentalism and just overall making the world a better place and more sustainable for everyone.
Mm-hmm. Great answer. And in your first semester, what classes are you currently enrolled in?
I'm taking Chem 105A, which is like Gen Chem 1, and then Math 126, which is Calc 2, and then I'm taking Intro to Environmental Engineering and Write 150.
Who's your writing 150 professor?
Professor Gold. She's really nice, and I really like her. So okay. It's a fun class.
Okay, awesome. Yeah, for those of you listening, that's a freshman year writing class that everybody takes. I took my professor's name was Jennifer Bankard. She was fantastic. I loved that class. I think it's still to my day one of my favorite classes at USC, which is a little funny as an engineer, but. Awesome. So what are your thoughts? What do you think about your classes? Which one's your favorite?
Oh my God, I definitely love my intro to environmental engineering class because it's just so different from all the other classes I've taken. Like most of the classes, like the lectures, they're taught by one professor, but my intro to environmental engineering class is kind of taught by the whole faculty. And it's just nice to see like different professors, their specific research and focus area. And it just learning like all routes of environmental engineering compared to just like the perspective of one professor.
Yeah, that's awesome. So what are some like examples of things that you've done? I'm trying to think back to my like beginning industrial and systems engineering course. What are some examples of things that you'll do in that class?
We mostly just listen to professors just kind of talk about the research, what they do. And it's a little nice because you kind of have like is more discussion based. You get to really talk to the professor, learn more about them, as well as like gaining knowledge for yourself about their type of research and what they do. And I guess it's just nice to, I guess, be comfortable with talking to a professor on that kind of level. Mm-hmm. Since as a freshman, it's kind of intimidating to just open up to professor, and it's just really nice to have that.
Oh, yeah. I remember over, I started my freshman year over Zoom, and yeah, that definitely was the most intimidating. Like, your professor just seemed so far off, and mm-hmm. It's really nice to have, I think, that intro class where you can talk to them and like start to develop a personal relationship, you know. And they're smaller classes too, correct? So you yeah. really get to, they get to know you as well as you get to know them. So how, so Chem 105A and Math 126, you said? So
yeah.
Calc 2 and Intro to Chemistry. How are those classes going? So I know those are that those are, I think, some of the ones that freshmen talk about the most as being really difficult. And I think that really yeah. marks the transition from like high school to college. So how have those classes been? What's that transition been like for you?
So chemistry was definitely something. Mm-hmm. I've never like I took chem in high school online over the summer. So it was definitely like a really weird transition to just like suddenly come here and there's like lectures and labs and everything. But I think like once I got the hang of it, it was fine. Mm-hmm. It's just like obviously like really content heavy and a lot in one moment. Mm-hmm. And for like math, I have a midterm this Friday. It's been rough, but we're pushing through.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. I think that's a pretty common freshman experience. Like, you're taking a lot of the science and the math classes. And mm-hmm. as a senior, I can say this with 100% confidence, like those will be the hardest classes you take.
Yeah.
Because it's like the transition from high school to college, like it can be difficult. And I don't know, just in general, I think math and science goes through a lot of different concepts very quickly. Mm-hmm. Have you been using any resources or like what have you found to be helpful in those classes?
Oh, they have like SI sessions where upperclassmen kind of bring together, I don't really know how to describe it. They kind of just help teach us the content mm-hmm. like an extra session, which is really nice since we only have so many lectures every week, and it's nice to just get that extra practice in as well as kind of learn the topic again. And mm-hmm. then also, I think Dorn's Life offers the free tutoring service, which has been pretty helpful for me, especially for chem.
Oh, nice. Yeah. Yeah, I know. I definitely use those resources as well. I got to know my SI instructor pretty well for Calc 3. Mm-hmm. So did my family, actually. I would like watch the Zooms and I'd be in the family room. He had a very nice British accent.
Oh, that's really cool.
made it very enjoyable. Yeah. I don't know. Is there anything else about your classes that surprised you about coming to USC?
I guess I wouldn't say surprising, mm-hmm. but I mean, I don't know. I watched a lot of those movies about like, I don't know, those like teenage movies where they go to college and stuff. And then I guess like USC is exactly like the movies, like the parties are like the movies, the classes are like the movies.
No way. Like which, give me an example of a movie.
Oh, I don't know.
I'm trying to think about a college movie too. Yeah, definitely feels like a movie at certain times. And then I'll be like in, I don't know, grinding away, like studying. And then I do realize like, oh wow, like the fresh, like me in high school would be so amazed at like what's going on right now.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. But I guess like for engineers, it's kind of different. Well, I don't know. I hang out at the libraries a lot. I kind of live in Levy. Mm-hmm. So I'm just like always in the whiteboards, like writing down my math problems.
Yeah, no, I love a good whiteboard moment, mm-hmm. particularly for calculus. Yeah. So satisfying. Actually, in my recommendation, I got an iPad like my sophomore year. It changed my mm-hmm. life. It's like a portable white pad. You bring it with you everywhere. I mean, whiteboard, white pad. Oh my gosh. iPad is a whiteboard.
I just bought a whiteboard and it's kind of been like my emotional support whiteboard. I kind of just like bring it with me everywhere to like write down my problems.
Let's see, we've covered classes and like expectations, reality, what you're currently enrolled in. Let's talk about things outside of classes. How have you like acclimated to college life and adjusted to living in the dorm? And like which dorm are you living in?
So I'm currently living in McCarthy, and I just I think like most of my friend group, they're kind of like my neighbors in McCarthy. So I'm friends with like the girls next door and then the guy across. And everyone's just been like really nice. I don't know. I just really love my friend group. Everyone's like really supportive of each other. And it's just nice to have that like support system, especially being in a new environment and everything. And then over the summer, I started collecting these tiny baby dolls called Sony Angels.
I think I know what you're talking about.
Yeah. I think, okay, some people think they're kind of weird because they're like naked, but I think they're really cute. And I just kind of carry one with me to class as like emotional support. And it's just really nice to have them like chill while I study in the library. Like they're watching me.
You have like the collection of little baby dolls. That's the recommendation for all of you guys listening. You know, bring a little baby doll.
Yeah. Or like a little trinket.
Get your emotional support thing. No, I have an emotional support stuffed animal. It's a stuffed sloth.
Yep. That's so cute.
Sitting right next to me right now, listening to this podcast.
Yeah, my Sony angels are all staring at me right now. They're like in a row.
Awesome. Have you gotten involved in any clubs or any different organizations on campus?
Oh, so I'm currently a member of SWE, the Society of Women Engineers. And recently I just went to the conference actually yesterday and on Friday. It's been pretty nice since, I don't know, as a freshman, it's just really nice to get involved in and, I don't know, start being involved in networking and opening up to professionals within the field. And especially like learning about what engineering has to offer has been really nice as well. Mm-hmm. And then everyone in SWE has been pretty nice. So that's been fun. Mm-hmm. And then I'm also on the board for the Environmental Student Assembly.
Oh, so, cool.
Yeah. And then it's just nice to hear professors and speakers come in and talk about, last week we had a professor come in and talk to us about how we can help people understand environmentalism better and climate change better. And that's been really helpful, especially since I'm involved a bit in the advocacy side of for the environment.
Okay. Awesome. Yeah. You're super involved for a freshman. Are you kidding me? Been here for 10 weeks. Yeah. I actually used to be a part. Well, I am still a part of SWE, but I used to be a big part of SWE a couple of years ago. And I actually was at the conference as well. I was a little overwhelmed by the career fair. It was a lot. I'm not going to lie. Mm-hmm. But yeah, the rest of the conference was super awesome. Did you talk to any specific companies or like have any, I don't know, any great stories from the conference?
Yeah, actually, I just start talking to people in line and everyone's just really nice. And I also met another girl. She was an environmental engineer and there's so little of us. And that's something I guess I didn't realize since a lot of the companies I talked to, they didn't know what environmental engineering was. And I was like, oh, I had to like sit there and explain to them what it was. Mm-hmm. But I think it's a growing field. So hopefully when I graduate, maybe everyone will know what it is.
Yeah. Kind of the same with my major, industrial and systems engineering, honestly. Mm-hmm. Sometimes you do have to explain what that means and also what that means at USC. You know, like I think industrial and systems engineering at USC isn't necessarily the same as it would be at another school. Mm-hmm. So like explaining like, I don't know, your specific background and what you're interested in and like, yeah. And I know like some industrial and systems engineers will work in different positions. Like you're not necessarily going to work as an industrial engineer when you graduate. Just like people with a background in environmental engineering, like I'm sure there are multiple different words, different names for environmental engineer in the future. And also like, I'm sure some people go into things that aren't necessarily environmental engineering.
Yeah, I actually learned on Friday from talking to someone that there's something called wildfire engineering. And it's just like really interesting to see like all the different types of engineering, like there's cost engineering, project engineering, wildfire engineering, and just like so many different engineerings that you wouldn't think about.
Yeah. What is wildfire engineering?
Honestly, I wasn't really sure when she was explaining it, but now that I'm thinking about it, I think she mentioned that it was a lot of like data analytics and just tracking wildfires. I think it's like a really niche field. It was like specific for their company.
Oh, interesting. Interesting. Mm-hmm. Oh, very cool. Yeah, I didn't even think about that. I know some professors at USC as well do research. I don't know with wildfire tracking, but I do know actually have a brother at USC, and in the past he worked with an environmental engineering professor, and he was doing some data analytics work for, I don't know, I'm going to totally be a bad sister and forget what it was about, but it was environmental engineering and data analytics. That's all I know.
That's really cool.
The SWE conference as well. Yeah, it's awesome to get involved as a freshman like that. I'm trying to encapsulate like the entire process of coming to USC and college and getting involved, other than the mini baby collection. Yeah. What has really helped you think, make the transition from high school to college, you know, being involved in things like starting to think about careers, like what's helped that? Or like, what do you wish you had done differently?
I guess what helped me was definitely my friends. It's just nice to know that some people are going through the same thing as you are. Like for most of the freshmen, everything is really new and different, and it's different for everyone to try to feel like they fit in here. Mm-hmm. And you asked me what was my struggle or.
Yeah. Yeah. Is there anything that you would do differently? Or like, is there anything you particularly struggled with? Sounds like you're very involved, but I know that we all have our struggles. I definitely had a lot of struggles.
I guess I struggle a lot with like kind of trying to find my study habits, because studying in high school is definitely different from studying here. Mm-hmm. And I guess like here, your study needs to be more like, I guess, I don't know if proactive is mm-hmm. the right word. You just kind of need to be like more on top of things. And just, I guess, be more involved with the studying aspect.
Yeah, I think proactive is a really good word for it, because it's not, a lot of your class in college is like your lecture is teaching, but you're not in lecture for like 8 hours a day like you would be in high school. So a lot of it is like you make your own schedule and like manage your own time and figure out when you need to study versus like your teacher gives you time or like there's a specific homework assignment. So I think that was something that I really struggled with, was figuring out like what schedule worked for me. And how to get like all my work done, but also still, you know, have a great social life and, I don't know, not be super stressed out.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, balance is definitely a struggle for me.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I think, and especially as a freshman, like there are so many different events to attend. There are so many different things that you can join and be a part of. Mm-hmm. So I think my freshman year, I definitely joined a lot of things. And then like sophomore and junior year realized like it's not feasible for me to do all of these things. Mm-hmm. So then I definitely took a step back, but definitely a struggle and so different from living at home and being in high school.
Yeah, because I guess like here, not only are you trying to balance your classes, you're also trying to build like your professional life and like your network and everything. Mm-hmm. So I guess it's kind of hard to balance that and then I guess like separate school from your social life and everything, and just like keeping a balance at everything has definitely been in the struggle.
Yeah. Well, you seem to be doing a lot of things well, so I'm sure that'll carry over into the balance as well. And I think it comes naturally as you get like more and more semesters through and become more familiar with the school. Let's talk about favorite events. Have you gone to any events as a freshman where you're like, this is so fun or this is so awesome?
I don't know if frat parties count as an event. I've been to a couple. They've been nice. I like the one during family weekend. My mom went with me, so that was kind of nice. I was surprised that she even went with me in the first place, but it was
awesome. What was the family weekend event?
We just went on frat row and started partying. And that was the event.
My parents love coming. Mm-hmm. They love all the family weekend events.
Yeah. I'm glad like my family's locals, and sometimes they just come here, drop off fruit for me or like food. And it's been nice to have them around.
Let's see. Is there any piece of wisdom that you'd want to share with prospective students? Or so I know that you and I were both talking at the beginning of this podcast that we listened to Viterbi Voices a bit as we were writing our applications and applying to Viterbi. And I think that's what a lot of our listeners are doing. So do you have any advice for those prospective students, you know, people who want to apply to USC, but like kind of want to understand what that experience is going to be like? know, what's your advice for people applying? And yeah, why should they apply?
Well, I mean, I really love this school. I really love like the culture here and how, I guess like how everyone is excited to come here. I think that's been really lovely since I don't think that any other school is like that. And I guess for people who are thinking of applying, definitely apply. I mean, you never know what's going to happen. And actually, I didn't think that I was going to apply here until like 2 months before the early action deadline mm-hmm. was due. So, I mean, like, yeah, just go for it. I wouldn't be here if I didn't apply. And I didn't know that this was the school I was going to fall in love with. So, I mean, you just never know. Mm-hmm. Definitely shoot your shot and maybe something good will come out of it.
Yeah. Yeah. That's great advice. And I honestly would give the same advice. You know, I like never thought that I would get into USC completely, mm-hmm. honestly, like it was a dream school. But I just applied and I was like, we'll see what happens. And like, you never know. So never be the one to tell yourself no. And if you think you're interested, definitely apply because there are a ton of opportunities to learn more about it and yeah, make your decision later on. So mm-hmm. agreed. Are there any other pieces of wisdom, any other fun things that have happened your freshman year that you want to talk about or share with the people?
Let's see. Recently, I've been eating a lot of sweet treats, so definitely reward yourself after a long, hard week or day of midterms. And I don't know, it's just have fun.
Nice. I'm a big proponent of the sweet treat. I mm-hmm. just had a cookie earlier today because it was a long day and I did a good job today. So cookie, well deserved. How's the food been?
Oh.
Yeah, it's a hot take.
It's been rough. EVK gave me a really upset stomach one time. So I haven't touched EVK in like a month and a half. Mm-hmm. Usually I've just been sticking to the village and like the little sandwiches that they have. Mm-hmm. That you can like customize them. And I guess they're like the safest thing to eat. I don't really know. I'm just too scared to eat anything else that will give me an upset stomach. But the crepes are so bomb. Like mm-hmm. one time I just sat there and ate like 3 crepes because mm-hmm. they were because after a long day there you just need like something sweet.
A sweet treat.
And, mm-hmm. and I don't know. I munch them up. The crepes.
Yeah. Yeah. I love the crepes at the UC mm-hmm. dining hall. Definitely a highlight. That's in the village dining hall, right?
Yeah.
Awesome. And I will vouch for the village dining hall. I think like the specials that they have are normally pretty good. Like I've personally never had an upset stomach, but I've also only ever eaten at the village dining hall, which is kind of crazy. But mm-hmm. yeah, I had a bunch of like the apartment dining plan my sophomore year because I lived in the village and I just exclusively went to the village. Brunch also. Brunch is great.
Mm-hmm, the omelets.
Oh, yeah.
The omelets are so good.
Yeah. It's interesting hearing you talk about this too. I know like my little sister originally was bragging. She's like, my school has better food than yours. She goes to the University of San Diego. But even as a freshman now, she's like, yeah, I'm sick of the dining hall food. Which is like, yeah, it's fun. You find your balance. But yeah, definitely a lot to be eating at the same place every day.
Yeah, my sister goes to UCLA and I think they have like the best dining hall in the nation. And she always just sends me pictures and I'm so jealous because they have like Korean fried chicken and like chicken sandwiches. And I'm like, man, I wish we had that, but at least we had get unlimited crepes. So
yeah, unlimited crepes, tuition, worth it.
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. Awesome. Well, thank you for joining me today. This has been really fun, really interesting for me to hear about a freshman's perspective. And I'm hoping that it's been pretty informative for the people listening to this podcast. Like I'm a senior, I may be years removed, but like, I know, I think your experience is like pretty similar to what people, like an example of what people could expect coming into USC. So thank you for taking the time to be on the podcast. I'm excited for everybody to hear it.
Well, thank you so much for having me. I had a lot of fun as well.
Welcome back, everybody. I hope you enjoyed that conversation as much as I did. It was really nice to revisit freshman year, you know, some of those like ideas coming into college, some of those like really exciting experiences when you're experiencing it for the first time. And I know, like, for me as well, who started during COVID, I really enjoy, like, maybe a little bit bitter, but I really enjoy hearing about like all the awesome freshman experiences
that
the current freshmen are getting in person. Yeah. Things I didn't get to do, but things that are still like really important. And I can relate in my sophomore year as well. Like, I lived in a dorm, I lived in the village. So,
right. We're outside of those differences. What resonated the most as something you heard where you're like, yeah, me too. Or like, were mm-hmm. you, where maybe you've heard across other people, like your friends' experiences, what was the one thing that like you thought was like, yeah, that's a standard, you know, disappointed feeling. That's a standard, exciting new thing you found, anything like that?
Yeah. One thing that we discussed was like, it can be really difficult to find balance your first year.
Yep.
Because there are so many new things. There are so many new variables that are being introduced to your life. You know, like, you're living on your own for the first time, like, you're managing your own social calendar. Like, you don't have to like ask your parents whether you can like take the car, or like go somewhere at a certain time. And also like your classes are different. You know, you're not in class for 9 hours a day. Your classes are a lot shorter, and like there's more that's expected of you. So you have to set your own schedule for what you're involved in and like how you're spending your time. So we spoke about like, it can be difficult to balance that at first, but at the end of the day, one thing that's really helpful is just like a network of friends and like having grace for yourself, you know, like understanding like this can be a really difficult thing. But like it will get better, and you kind of just gotta like experiment. Like, it's okay. We're all making mistakes with that. I am still making mistakes.
I've often found that this idea of balance and messing up, for lack of a better term, like, oh, like, damn, I messed up. Like the idea of not, you don't realize how balance is so important until things get unbalanced, I think is the basic issue there. And oftentimes I've heard you and other students talk about this. And then I've often heard a number of high school students recently essentially try to crack the code with you all. Like, okay, so what should I do differently? And it's really interesting because you all think about it for a while. And then I think you don't know how to tell them. It's like, you're not supposed to crack the code. Like, the whole point is to go through this, to get knocked off your feet and then figure out how to get back up again. And that is the lesson that you're supposed to learn, not that you're supposed to come into this with a plan that's going to keep you balanced. Does that make sense?
Yeah. And if you come into it expecting a plan, like you will find yourself very disappointed very quickly, because there is no one right way to do it. And honestly, like the best way to do it, I feel like, shifts over time as well, as your interests shift and the things that you're involved in or the things that you enjoy change as well. So yeah, definitely a good piece of advice, you know, coming into it with an open mind and just having a lot of grace for yourself.
Yeah. Grace is, I think, the issue. Like, oh, I messed up. It's not the end of the world. Mm-hmm. We will rebound as we move through this. Definitely, definitely a big deal. Have you thought about how this conversation might be resonant in your first year out of college?
I haven't. But as soon as you say that, and I think a lot of the experiences, like living on your own for the first time, experiencing a new thing, like that's really transferable to experiences outside of college, you know. Like I don't, and also like right now I'm kind of in the same boat as I was with like college applications, where there are like multiple different places I could see myself and multiple
you mean
different
you're
things.
In the same boat as far as applying to companies?
Yes
yeah,
kind right. of like so, the, yeah, kind of
very similar to college applications. You have applications to getting a job.
Yes and okay. Also like the mental, like the thinking through, like there are multiple different like cities I could live in that I could be happy with, just as there were like multiple different areas of the country I was looking at for college. So it's kind of like which one do I want to try out? And I think also having that mindset, like nothing I choose now is going to be like what I'm signing up to do for the rest of my life, you know, like a major or something. It's just like what I think I'm interested now. So actually like listening to your info sessions, that's also a good reminder. Like, just go with something that like you think you're interested in and try it out. And if you're not, you can always do something else. So
it's true. It's really true. the more relaxed you're going to be, the better you're going to be in this situation.
Yeah.
Which is probably like the worst advice to tell an engineer.
They're like, what do you mean relaxed?
Don't prepare, just relax. Mostly because, and the reason I say that is like, you probably give the opposite advice to someone who's not an engineer. But because an engineer is constantly preparing and constantly doing the work and constantly ready mm-hmm. to go, it's like, trust in the fact that you've done that for so mm-hmm. long and you are ready. And you'll land on your feet. That doesn't mean you don't put out effort, right? You don't actually put out the mm-hmm. effort to do those things. And I think I want to make sure that I highlight that everyone, because I know you understand that, but maybe not all of our listeners do. Like, you know, just like, no, something will land in my lap. No, mm-hmm. it's not that necessarily. It's a spectrum, and there's somewhere in the middle that you need to go.
It's like the same coming to USC as well. You know, like there are so many opportunities, but it's like you have to put yourself out there in order to get them. Mm. You know, like we have career fairs, but they're not going to walk up to you and offer you a job. True. You know, like you have like all these resources available, but you have to be the one who like uses them and puts some effort in as well.
Yeah, absolutely. Absolutely. Yeah. Very cool. So on to more fun
topics.
Funner topics. Thanksgiving, I know for all of our listeners, it has already passed. But do you have the standard way in which your family celebrates Thanksgiving? You're flying home today. What are you looking forward to? What are you dreading?
Oh man. Okay. Well, I'm getting deja vu. I feel like we had this conversation last year.
We did.
Maybe I'll listen to the episode again.
Did we have it about Thanksgiving or do we have it about the holidays?
I think maybe like both, honestly, but I'll listen to the last episode and see if my answer changed. I feel like it's probably the same, but I'm very excited to see my family. Also, my little sister just started college. This was her first semester freshman year. So she's also flying home. So I'm really excited for the whole family to be together. And I saw her a little bit earlier this semester, but just excited to see her in person and hear more about her experience.
Where's she going to school?
She's at the University of San Diego.
USD. That's right. Mm-hmm. Okay. And how often have you seen her throughout the year?
Yeah, I actually just saw her once at the beginning of the semester. Mm-hmm. It's been a crazy one, but I hope to see her and get down to San Diego more. I also have a car now, so hoping to drive down and see her a little bit more next semester.
I always find it interesting and when a student comes back for Thanksgiving after their first year, what are they keeping from their parents?
I don't know. Honestly, my family has a very open communication. Yeah.
Well, that's good.
Which is great. So I don't know if there's anything she's keeping from me. And I also don't know if there's anything she's keeping from my parents. She's a big sharer. Which is awesome.
Very cool.
But other things I'm looking forward to. Looking forward to my dog. Looking forward to just, like, I know I said Thanksgiving break is a trap, but I'm still going to try and rest and take like at least a couple days off.
Yeah.
And what I am dreading is the cold. I think it's like 10 degrees at home right now, which is
exactly what you said last year.
Kind of ridiculous. So every time I'm like, if there's not snow, I don't want it to be cold. You know, like I'll put up with it for a couple
days. What you said last year. You were having the exact same conversation. Not that everyone listens year to year to year. Yeah. Like I think we have new listeners every single year. But you were saying, I wonder if I'm going to say the same thing. And I'm like, I don't know. Go ahead. And then I'm like, no, this is exactly what we talked about last year.
This is what I say. And this is what I think every year. And it's like, I would put up with it if it's like just, you know, holiday cheer, snow, like absolutely love it. But if it's just cold for no reason, I don't want to be there.
I hear you. Yeah. I mean, and then I think the exact same thing I said last year, which I will say again, is we have this weird weather around Thanksgiving all the time. We're like right now, it's going to be super hot today. We're going to be in like the 80s over the next 2 days. And it's going to be dry weather and Santa Ana winds. And it's like not fun. And it's incredibly uncomfortable. And it's kind of weird, but it also gets super cold at night. Like it gets down to like the 40s. Mm-hmm. And when I say super cold, I understand for the majority of the people in the world, that is not super cold. But for us in LA, that is super cold.
Mm-hmm. And so honestly, even me in LA, I'll whip out my jacket, drive like biking home from class at 6 p.m. It's like 60 degrees. It's cold.
Uh-huh. Well, we got the heater on in the house here this morning, but I know it's going to be 80 degrees this afternoon. And so it's just, you know, oof, whatever. Do you do the traditional Thanksgiving, like turkey? What's on the table for Thanksgiving?
Yeah, the traditional Thanksgiving, which I think, again, this is probably what I said last year. I think my dad is the only person who likes traditional Thanksgiving, but he loves traditional Thanksgiving. So that means we always do traditional Thanksgiving.
Got it.
So
got
yeah, it. Like turkey, cranberries, stuffing, mashed potatoes. The last year I added.
Stuffing in the bird or dressing on the side? How is it prepared?
Stuffing on the side. You know, like it's like breadcrumbs, sausage.
Well, see, that's the next question. So then what is it?
I was like, is that a Midwestern thing?
That's what I'm asking, because there are different definitions of these, no matter where you come from.
I don't know. It's like a side dish for us.
But it's not cooked in the bird.
It's not cooked in the bird, no.
So that's technically dressing.
Dressing. But it's interesting. I wonder if it's...
Now, I called it stuffing my entire life, regardless of whether it's cooked in the bird or not. But I get my understanding recently, and correct me if I'm wrong, everybody in the world, but it's called stuffing when it's made in the bird, and it's called dressing when it's on the side. And then the definition of what either of these things are and how you make it is very different. Like you just mentioned sausage, which is a very key element in some ingredients. And I never grew up with sausage. Mine was always just like breadcrumbs and celery and whatever, like, you know, chicken stock flavors and stuff like that.
Breadcrumbs and celery.
It's basically what it is, but I love it. It's fantastic. And I love stuffing. Some people hate stuffing. And then there's people that do like, I think it's a Southern element, like oyster dressing. Make it with oysters.
What? I like oysters, but this is like a whole new Thanksgiving world.
Oyster dressing, sausage dressing is a big deal. Okay. There's some people that say you never want to put dressing in the bird because it'll dry it out, and you want to put a bunch of aromatics in there, and they put like oranges inside the bird.
Yeah,
like...
I think we do aromatics for sure. Okay. Like stick some spices in it. I don't know what exactly. I don't know if we do oranges, but... My parents did something new last year that was pretty good. I'm not a big turkey fan, but like it's okay.
Okay. Okay. Well, yeah, I'm a fan. I'm a big fan of the Thanksgiving dinner. I always, because I eat way too much, and every year I go into it saying I need to not eat so much so that I feel sick afterwards that I ate so much. But I know I'm going to get it wrong at some point. I'm going to probably get too much in there.
Rite of passage. Yeah. Do you watch the football after?
Sometimes in the background, I kind of don't care. I'm not the biggest NFL fan in general, although I went to the Rams game on Sunday. And so I went to Rams Seahawks. That was interesting. That was kind of cool. SoFi is just an awesome place in general, which I know we've talked about a few times, but finally went to a Rams game there, which was really, really cool. Had some good seats. Yeah, we'll watch some football, but not really. I think it's much more about like playing games and hanging out, card games, stuff like that. What we can do.
It's another thing I'm excited for about break. There's the Gopher Badger football game. So that's the University of Minnesota and Wisconsin-Madison. And we live like 30 minutes away from the University of Minnesota. So we're all big Gopher fans. So this is like a big Big Ten showdown on Saturday, where it's like most of my friends go to either one of the schools. So I think—
Is there a nickname for that game?
It's the Gopher Badger game. They get the axe is like what they like send between.
Paul Bunyan's axe?
Yeah.
Yeah. So, but there's not a name for the, because like, that's what's so funny is there's like three games that get something related to Paul Bunyan, right? Isn't there like three different football games in the Midwest that relate to Paul Bunyan?
I don't know, but I do know Paul Bunyan. Yeah. We actually went on like, I don't know, like field trips in elementary and middle school to like the Paul Bunyan Museum. But
at one point I knew this. When I was really into college football, like all of the different rivalry games and what they're called, like I think Oregon State's the Civil War. There's a few others that are nicknamed that. And then the thing that gets passed between them. And then I remember there's like three different rivalry games that all involve some sort of relic of Paul Bunyan. And I'm like, this is such a big deal.
Yeah, no, it's actually called the Border Battle.
It's
very apt because we are right on the border of Wisconsin and Minnesota. So we are like the border battle, if not anywhere else, is the border battle.
Got it. Yep. So see, they all got their nicknames. They all got their nicknames of what that game's going to be. And now, I mean, we're done. USC's completely done and completely just slid off the map after those last half of the season. Did you go to all the games?
I did. Actually, this is probably my first year going to all of the home games. And yeah, the last game was really sad, but I really still did enjoy like just going to the games this year. And I think, I don't know, my friends were definitely more like, we're all more into watching it now, I think, which means like that the physical act of going to a game is more fun than it was like by sophomore year. Just good. Yeah. And I'm really excited to see USC in the Big Ten. Like USC can enjoy my Thanksgiving 10 degree weather.
Yeah. So you said you're Gopher fans or Wisconsin fans at home?
Gopher.
Oh, because Wisconsin's playing at USC.
Yeah, that's actually I have a couple friends who play for the team actually. So that'll also be interesting. But
Yeah, we're lots of conversations right now in the admission world about Wisconsin USC because that lines up with a conference that will be going on in LA for admission professionals. I don't know if I've ever told you, we go to a annual conference of admission counselors. I think,
was that the one that was in Baltimore this year?
Yes. Gosh. It was in Baltimore. This year it is in LA. And so USC is obviously going to play a big part in it because we're, for lack of a better term, hosting, right? So like people are visiting LA and we should put on a big event for USC. And we're talking a lot about that weekend is USC versus Wisconsin at the Coliseum. So we might want to figure out how to.
I might be there. Might have to go to that game. We'll see. We'll see what my friends are doing. But yeah.
It'll be very cool. It'll be very, very cool. Well, cool. Good stuff. Well, I think that wraps up all of this episode here. I think there's enough talk of turkey and enough talk of pie. And actually, we didn't talk about pie. What's your go-to pie? Is it pumpkin for Thanksgiving?
No, I'm not a big pumpkin fan. I like fruit pies. So typically like a tart, like a raspberry or like a, I don't know, cherry.
Interesting. Interesting. Okay, cool. I got to have pumpkin pie on Thanksgiving. Mm-hmm. I got to have it. It's really the only time that we're going to have it. So you got to go big in that. Now we've talked enough about pie. So we've talked enough about turkey and we've talked enough about dressing and stuffing and we've talked enough about pie. We've talked enough about finals and final projects and how Thanksgiving is just a trap, but we're going to have a good time anyway. We have just two more episodes for this particular first part of season. We're in season 8, right? Season 8?
I think so.
All of a sudden, I just kind of forgot of this year of the podcast. And so bear with us, folks, as we get through this episode, then the penultimate of this semester next week and the ultimate episode the week following. After that, this is fair warning that we will be off the air. We will not be releasing new episodes for a couple weeks as Maya and the rest of the students and myself take a little break. We'll be breaking for the winter break. We'll give you enough forewarning on that in the future episodes as well to come back, and we'll be joining you in January with brand new episodes. But we still got two more episodes before that. So thanks for joining us this week, and we will be back next week with a whole new episode of Viterbi Voices. Thanks for being here, folks. Bye-bye.